Hey guys, so today I'm going to be answering the evaluation question. In what ways does your media product use, develop, or challenge forms and conventions of real media products? So I think the first really important bit to talk about in the question is where we actually use conventions, develop them, and then put like our own kind of spin on them. So I guess the first kind of thing that's really evident with our trailer is that we have a female villain. And that kind of goes along with Barbara Creed's monstrous feminine idea. So it's the idea that traditionally in horrors and scary stories and Greek mythology, that it's always been women who've played the evil characters, and women have this evil streak in them and things like that. So we really wanted to kind of play on this idea and develop it, which is why we went with picking a female character. And again, it kind of foreshadows the girls' future in the trailer as well, because we have Alex, Jane, Tiffany and Riley, four girls, no boys present, so it kind of, you know, it kind of like goes to them. There's no sense of male dominance over the girls. It's another female. In a similar way, it's actually Tiffany who's the one who gets possessed in the trailer. So yeah, we can see that from the part where Tiffany goes to answer the door, and she's the only one who sees our villain. She then has to run up the stairs. She feels different. All these kind of changes are happening. So again, it's the monstrous feminine occurring again, like a continuous cycle where it's now Tiffany who's become possessed. The next theory that we kind of played on was the idea of Carol J. Clover's final girl. And of course, naturally there being four girls, you can expect the last character is going to be a female. So we made Alex our final girl. Alex is the girl whose house it is and the other girls are at. So again, we thought that it would be a really nice idea to kind of have at least one girl who survives. It doesn't make it out to be that much of a slasher film. We found with our research that not a lot of people like slasher films. For our age range, it was just a bit too gory, and being a more girly kind of film, girls don't in general tend to go for slasher films. They like more of storyline, character development. Those are the kind of things which attract girls to this kind of movie. If we were appealing to guys, we probably would have used other techniques, more slasher aspects, more dominance. There would have been more nudity maybe, but again, we were appealing to a different kind of audience and we therefore went for a different approach. I think a really important convention that we used in all of our products, so the magazine, the poster and the trailer, was Barth's Enigma Code, where we use a lot of iconography and a lot of symbolic codes. This is really important for us, especially because we found through our research that religion was something that a lot of people found scary in horror films, because a lot of people are religious or they have religious beliefs, and playing on those kind of things makes it that much more real and relatable. So using iconography and symbolic codes, we found that we could make things in the scene really like relatable. So this was done through using Christmas lights that the villain was holding in the magazine and the poster. So in the poster, the female's got it around her hand, just here. And then in the magazine, it's on her head here. So I think that it's really interesting how the lights are kind of like barbed wire, they resemble barbed wire. So again, it's playing on this iconography that, you know, these Christmas lights are meant to symbolise something holy and pure, and just generally like a really, really festive time. But in this case, you know, they're used as a weapon, they're used to strangle, they used like barbed wire. So I think it's quite cool how we managed to like play on that and put a twist on it, kind of like using binary opposition, where we show all this good stuff, all this festivity, happiness and joy, and how it so easily turned into something quite sinister and dark and evil. When I was conducting my research, Mulvey was someone who constantly came up in horror movies. So her theory was the theory of the male gaze. She conducted research and published her findings called Visual Pleasure and Narrative Cinema. So in that, we thought that it'd be quite cool again to put aspects of that in. Again, it was a bit hard because we had four girls, but something that Mulvey makes evident in her research is that in almost every single horror film, you'll find that it's done through the gaze of a male. That might be because directors are predominantly male, but again, it's something that attracts the audience to see women presented in a certain kind of way. So again, we thought that this would have to be put in and slipped in certain places if we wanted to appeal to the mass audience. So what we did here was on our poster, we made it through a peephole. It's not very clear on here, but I'll pop a picture up. So this kind of makes the audience feel like their privacy is being invaded. I think it's quite ironic how people use peepholes to look out of their house. It's for their own safety, for their own, you know, privacy and stuff. But in this case, it kind of makes your personal home feel like invaded, like all your privacy has just been taken away from you. Again, in this one, the female character is looking down on you, sense of dominance, you know, you're lower than her, things like that. And then moving on to the trailer, we had scenes like Romara or Alex in the trailer in her bedroom, where it's really, you know, intimate space. It's a girl's bedroom, she's on her bed. There were other angles, like when the girls were around the Christmas tree, you could see them dancing around, having, you know, a good fun girly time. And again, that's quite an intimate space. There's no guys around, it's four girls having fun by themselves. You know, Tiffany and Jane, who I played, are in quite revealing clothes. So again, it's quite invasive of girls' privacy. Another bit, I think, which captured this really well was where Tiffany had to run upstairs into the bathroom, and you get this amazing shot where Tiffany's, you know, really struggling to get up the stairs. You can see her whole body as she walks past. She's wearing a crop top, so you can see her belly, and again she goes up into the bathroom, which is a very, very private place. You know, she's closed the door expecting no one to be in there, but lo and behold, the villains followed her in there, and so have we, the audience. We're watching her, you know, in the bathroom in a private space, and again, that's really invasive of her privacy. Cohen's Moral Panics, I felt, was something that we could include because it's just such a big thing to use in horror films, because it adds that aspect of like allowing the audience to kind of relate. Cohen's Moral Panics kind of explains the theory behind why we find horror films so scary when there were things that we can relate to. So we used Christmas. Christmas is a holiday which everyone enjoys. Everyone knows what Christmas is, or at least hope so. And it's something, therefore, everyone can kind of watch the film, relate to, and really not want that kind of thing to happen to them. So playing on this, putting things in the scene that allow the audience to relate to it, so setting it in a normal home on a normal street with four normal girls, just really adds the element of scare because it could literally happen to anyone. And then making the scene more relatable by using symbolic codes and iconography again from Barth's Enigma Code, putting in things like the Bible, candles, lights, things that really kind of enforce the fact that this is just a completely normal scene. I think the final convention that we used was Todorov's equilibrium theory, which we tried to make really, really evident in the trailer. So we went from showing everyone in a nice state of equilibrium, everyone's jolly, happy, and then we get our disruption period where Tiffany goes to the door and there's that mysterious being there, when Ramara answers the phone as well, and there's a strange voice on the side. So we really did try to show all the stages, and then towards the end you can kind of see where all the girls are reciting verses from the Bible. And you can see that's where the repair stage might take place. You don't know because you don't see the ending of the trailer, you don't know how it's going to end. But I think we really did try to make it clear that we were really going to heavily play on this convention, because of course we wanted to put into practice the theory of the final girl, where you know, maybe not all the girls will survive, but at least one of them will. So we get our kind of reinstatement of equilibrium stage. It's not perfect reinstatement, but it's, you know, it's somewhat kind of there. So yeah, I think we really did try to make this one really evident and clear in our trailer. I think we managed to challenge some conventions really well. So we subverted the typical way of doing a trailer or magazine cover or poster. So first of all, we had no males in the trailer. You can't see any male on the poster or magazine either. So this kind of made it a bit harder to play on things like the male gaze, but again, using the gaze of the camera and the gaze of the audience, we could still put it into practice. This of course meant that it's a lot easier to make the final girl really evident because there's no distraction in the way, and it makes the other girls kind of stand a better chance. You see in loads of other films like Cabin in the Woods, where girls get distracted by the male, they get led astray into forests or by lakes and things like that, where they then meet their death. In this case, there are no males, there is no distraction, the girls just have to focus on surviving. So that's where we kind of went against the convention of having guys in a teen horror. The other thing that we didn't really have much of in our trailer was dialogue. There were bits of it, like where Alex answered the phone, the girls were screaming, and things like that, but we really did want to kind of set this dark ambience, or like sinister, a sinister kind of mood throughout, where you don't really get to know much of the characters. There isn't much character development in the actual trailer itself. You literally just have to sit back, look at what the girls are wearing, look at how they talk from what dialogue is there, and kind of make a judgment. And that's what we really, really did want to enforce here, was that the four girls all dress in a really, really different way, and how that kind of makes us think. And stereotypically, Tiffany, just her name itself, is a typical American girl name. It's used in loads of American films for the posh girl who's maybe a little bit slutty. We kind of tried to reinforce this by making Tiffany wear a crop top. There's Jane, who's like your rebellious type. She shows up at the door with beer bottles in her hand. Alex, who's your final girl, so she's the one with no distractions. She's well set. Nothing can stop her from surviving, basically. And then you've got Riley, who's just really innocent, the smart little cute girl. So yeah, I think we didn't really want to put in much dialogue because we wanted to kind of make the audience sit back and judge the characters and kind of figure out for themselves who was going to survive and what the different characters were like. So to summarise, I think throughout our three products, we used the conventions really well. We tried to put them into practice as much as we could and develop them, so put our own spin on them, and really just work through them, make sure we were doing the right thing. If we felt that it didn't work, we'd try and subvert it. So again, challenging the conventions, and just making our trailer really different to what you'd find typically. And from our research after our premiere, the feedback we got was that it wasn't very predictable. The audience really liked the storyline. They liked what conventions we did play on. They felt that we followed the conventions in all the right areas and then subverted them in a way that made it really, really different, but it still worked well. So I think all in all, we really did manage to slip the right conventions in the right place and then subvert the typical things in other right places. I think we were right not to add too much of a slasher element, just because of the audience we were appealing to. And again, in our research, it showed that slasher films weren't really liked much amongst our target age range. So adding small aspects of it, you know, a bit of blood and gore was necessary because that's what you would typically find in a horror. But I think we went along with the right theme of putting more religion in there, more of Cohen's, like, more panics with things like Christmas, so people could relate to it more. So I think our trailer, our magazine and our poster were really relatable, and I think they were really effective as well.